you could die in less than 4 weeks.
Tonight on Insight, knowing you're dying.
I didn't want to know what the statistics were.
You've just been told your father's going to die. You're not telling him.
It's sort of like a death sentence.
How long do you think I'll live? I wanted to know how much I could cram in.
Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Welcome, everybody. Good to have you here tonight. Penny, thank you so much for agreeing to talk to us tonight. You were admitted to hospital just yesterday. Can you explain to us what you have and why you're in hospital at the moment?
I have metastatic stage 4 breast cancer. And then last year, September, it's actually moved to the liver and lungs. And now only just last week, we found out it's in the brain.
And how are you feeling at the moment, Penny, in yourself?
In myself and the rest of the family, we've gone through a wild time with it, but we're complete acceptance of it. We understand a bit of my time frame, and I've had so much treatment that I cannot go through any more chemotherapy, 12 months, radiation therapy earlier, 12 months, and it's just my body, I'm losing so much weight. But now at the age of just turned 60, it's in such severe bad spots. As I said before, I know my body and I know that I cannot fight it anymore. I want to enjoy a quality of life with my family and friends and be happy about it.
Now, you very generously agreed to let us film you a couple of weeks ago when you were given your prognosis.
Yes.
So I know you have previously had a lot of questions about your likely survival time and how long it's likely to be, how long will you live for.
Yeah.
And I know we've discussed that a few times as we've had different changes and we've seen the cancer progress.
Yes. Now it's in the brain. We want to know what is the time frame now. I want to start planning things more. I'm very open about it and I suppose the word is empowering. I need to be able to handle things.
We know it's all coming. We just want to prepare.
If we imagine we had 100 people just like you, mm-hmm. who all had your sort of breast cancer that had spread to the liver and the bones and the brain, and we'd probably see the sort of middle 50 of that 100 people would probably be living between probably sort of 2 months to 8 months.
We thought that because you virtually gave that gauge before it in the brain, so or a little bit longer, okay.
No. Sometimes when you've got cancer and it's involving a few organs, things can take a sudden change.
Yeah.
So I think we had to be prepared for that possibility of things changing suddenly.
Yeah.
And the worst case would be that you could die in less than 4 weeks. You okay?
Yeah, I'm okay.
I've got more tissues here as well.
Yeah.
I think that the more likely scenario is probably that you'll have radiation to the brain.
Mm-hmm.
And I would expect sort of that 2 to 8 month type of range. And then there's also the group of 5 to 10 people on the other end of the range who actually the cancer gets under control, it plateaus out, and we're still sitting here talking about this in 12 months' time or longer.
We accept it, you know, and I'm happy to do it without the rest of the treatment because it was just making me so sick and I wasn't enjoying life. So now we can set a plan of what the rest of the time is, and as you say, it could be positive and for quite a few more months, or something bad could happen with my body. I can see things happening. I know my own body that things aren't good. We've still got the journey to go.
And I don't think that we should be giving up all hope because, as I said to you, often in these situations, we as doctors get it wrong. Please don't go out of the room thinking that all hope is lost.
Oh no, you know me, I'm already booked in for golf tomorrow.
People can surprise us and live a lot longer than we expected.
Mm-hmm.
And you are one of those people that if anyone's going to do that, it could well be you. So,
thank you.
Penny, I can't tell you how much I admired you when I first saw that tape piece and how you reacted to that conversation. You seem to have prepared yourself for the conversation, did you?
I have, and I should say we have as a family. instead of just telephoning people and talking about ourselves, we've actually put it into emails. Megan and I have sat down and written emails so that everyone knows the same thing. And we've done it regularly. And I think the whole family just appreciate it. And we can work then together. And they can talk to me honestly about it and talk to my husband and my two daughters. We've been preparing ourselves for 12 months to know that it's going to happen in the future at some stage, but I want the knowledge to be able to understand everything myself, and I want to be able to do things that I enjoy and not be lying in a bed for 12 months and being very, very sick. I want to play with my grandchildren.
Paul, I wanted to ask you, because you were present during that conversation as well, how did you feel?
Well, Jenny, I think that, you know, I've seen Penny while I wasn't going to all of the consultations with Penny and the doctor. I've seen Penny at home. I've seen her maybe when she's not looking as glamorous as she is tonight.
She looks pretty good, I
struggling.
Must say.
She's struggling, you know, and so I've been preparing myself. And, you know, I'd heard from Megan, our daughter, about what was the likely scenario. As time went on, it was becoming more evident that, you know, the prognosis was not going to be good. And I guess in having the knowledge of a period of time allows me, together with the daughters, Emma and Megan, and the grandchildren, to be able to have quality time together.
Do the grandchildren understand exactly what's happening, Penny? How old are they?
Yes. Jack's 12 in Cairns, and Isaac's 6, and Maddie's 3.5. And both mothers have explained to the children what is happening and done it in the most beautiful way that's possible.
Mm. Megan, you're Penny's daughter. What's it been like for you?
It's been a process. It's had its ups and downs. It's certainly been more difficult more recently. We know what's coming. We're prepared for that. We have an idea of what, you know, the time frame.
But were you prepared for that conversation? Was that what you expected
so.
As well?
Very much so. I mean, thanks to Dr. Kylie's sound advice and answering our questions and always keeping us informed at each stage through the process, we've known where things are at and what the different scenarios will be. The reality is never easy when it's actually happening, but it has certainly, it was expected.
Hmm. Astley, tell us about your situation and the extent of your cancer.
So I was diagnosed with melanoma 6 years ago. And then 5 years ago, things got really serious. The melanoma, so initially I had it on my right scapula, then it had spread to my underarmpit. And then I started a whole bunch of surgery. I had 3 or 4 operations. After each operation, it kept going worse. And then I'd started radiotherapy and chemotherapy. I'd always been trying to do things my way and sort of not sort of taking the status quo. And I had a conflict with one of the doctors where I was trying to get something else besides radiotherapy on to use some heat treatment. And the doctor, I guess out of frustration, came to me and basically said, the only way you're going to get out of this, the only way this cancer is not going to kill you is if something kills you first.
So that was how you found out your condition was terminal?
Terminal, yeah. So I was doing a Bachelor of Science at the time, so I had access to the medical literature, but I'd always chosen not to research it. I didn't want to know what statistics were, because it wasn't about the statistics, it was about me, it was about my journey.
So you didn't want that limit put on you?
No.
In any way?
No, because a limit defines a population, and that is not a population of me, it's a population of other people.
How did you react?
Initially, I was furious. I was really, really angry. Here I was doing everything I could, doing more than just the standard treatment to try and beat something that I deep down knew I was going to beat. Like, there was always a sense of I knew I was going to get better. And when I heard that, my initial response was just a big F you. Like, I had this real determination that I'm going to walk down and I'm going to see in a few years later, I'm going to look you in the eye and say, look, fuck you, you were wrong, I'm alive. And don't ever say it to anyone again. Like, you don't actually know me.
So you're not a person who says to the doctor, I want to know, like Penny, I want to know, how long have I got? What are the odds here with this?
Because the doctor doesn't know me. They can't. They can know the illness, they can know the disease, but cancer does not exist separately from me. It exists within me. And everything I do, I say, I think, I eat, I drink, affects that dynamic and that relationship.
So are you having treatment at the moment?
I'm about to start treatment. I've been off treatment for the past 2 years. And tomorrow I'll actually go in and have a chat to the doctors and pick up some new drugs. Something that I've chosen to start up again.
Wendy, you chose not to tell your dad, Ding, that he was dying from cancer a few years ago, that he had a terminal prognosis. Why did you choose not to tell him?
Okay, firstly, I think I'm from the culture, I'm from Chinese background.
And your dad didn't speak English?
No, not at all. Hmm. But Western culture more have got more openness and straightforward and independence. But for our culture, like the diagnosis, we won't tell the patients. The strategy, it's called protection mechanism. We don't want the patients know first because we all agree at this stage the patient is in a vulnerable stage. They need to be looked after. We need to shield the burden from their shoulders, like depression or anxiety.
Was the doctor with your dad as well?
That's right, yes.
Yeah.
And I say it's prey cancer. It's not a real cancer.
So you said he had a precancerous condition.
That's right.
That was very aggressive.
Because the cancer is a pancreatic cancer, it's very aggressive cancer. And when we first to see, when we went to the consultation, the doctor say it's a very aggressive one, and the likely life expectancy is around 3 to 9 months. And I agree with what Ashley said. I don't think doctor can say how long you can live, even though that is a statistic, this average statistics, but they're not God. You can't tell the patient how long they can live. I think it's it totally depends on the cancer cells, on the medical conditions, on their psychological stability. So it's a lot of factors depends how long the patient can survive.
So you withheld that information. The doctor is telling your father and you're translating?
That's right, yes.
But you're translating something different to what the doctor is saying?
Not exactly totally different. I didn't mention the word cancer because cancer is sort of like a death sentence.
How did you explain the treatment he was having then?
The treatment, like I say...
Like he had chemotherapy?
He had.
And he went to palliative care?
He went through all the things. He went through all the medical treatment. But what I told him, say, it was pre-cancer, so you have to be treated like the cancer patient. So we just try to avoid the word cancer to give him more hope and let him hold the faith.
You kept it from your mother as well?
Yeah, my mother is very vulnerable. She's very vulnerable person, so I made the decision can't tell her because if I told her, and she will collapse. So I just keep all the things through.
What was it like for you, Wendy, keeping that secret?
It's way very stressful, but it's not because the concealing things, because the cultural issue is understanding the doctors didn't trust me. Every time when I bring my dad to see doctor, doctor just show his, you can see from his eyes, he didn't trust me. So every time when I saw him, he said, we want to book interpreter for you. And because the family members can't do the interpretation for the patient.
Megan, when you were listening to Wendy's story, I mean, you're a daughter, she's a daughter. How were you reacting when you were listening to what she was saying?
It must have been so difficult for you. I think as you do need to be the strong one to support that parent. I'm lucky we can talk about it, you know, and I can only imagine how difficult that was for you because of that cultural sensitivity around it.
Was it difficult, Wendy, or was it something that was so much a part of the way that you do things that it was just accepted that was the way it was?
As a carer, it's very difficult because I carry all the burdens on my shoulders. Mm.
Is there a belief, or was there a belief that you had that he would live longer if he didn't know?
That's right. I still feel it's better not to tell him.
Why?
Because he can still hold the hope and the faith in the journey of recovery. If the patient, they don't have any hope or faith in the recovery, so they'll be shattered completely. They don't have any faith to live. I think actually to live is harder to die. I don't mean that it's a telling lie. This line is a beautiful line. It just supports them to go through the journey. So,
how long did your father live after the prognosis?
15 months.
15 months.
Yeah.
And you'd been told 3 months.
I've been
months.
Told that averagely, one doctor say 3 months, another one say the longest one is 9 months. But different people, different reactions.
I have quite a different reaction, because I feel that my hope and my positivity comes from knowledge about my condition and knowledge about the treatments available, and I feel empowered to make decisions about how I'll live the rest of my life with knowledge. That's what empowers me.
Tell us what you know, Connie. Tell us about your circumstances.
I'm 36. I'm a mum of 2 young kids, they're 6 and 7, and I've got terminal breast cancer. I was initially treated to cure when it was just breast cancer, and 6 months later it had spread all through my body. Despite rigorous chemotherapy and radiation, it had spread throughout my whole body, and I was told at that point that it was incurable.
How long ago was that?
That was in 2010, so just over 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And my first question was, how long do you think I'll live? Because I wanted to know how much I could cram in. And I also wanted to know if I would live long enough that my children could grow up to an age where they would remember me, because I was 4 and my brother was 3 when our mother passed away, and we don't have any memories of her. And to me, that was shattering, because my children were 3 and 4 when I was diagnosed. And the thought of me dying then, when they were that age, was too much for me.
And what sort of time frame were you given recently?
What they told me at the beginning was that the average young woman diagnosed with breast cancer, with metastatic breast cancer, will live 3 years. But within that, like Penny's doctor said, there's people who live days from diagnosis, and there are people who live 10 years from diagnosis. All they know is that they won't be able to cure it, but that the average is 3 years. And I've now lived beyond that average. And miraculously, I'm still here, and my kids are at that age now where I think they will remember me.
How have you approached it with your children?
I haven't told them that I'm terminal. I haven't explained what terminal means.
How old are they? 6 and 7?
6 and 7. Mm. Yeah, just turned 6 and 7. So our approach to it has changed a little bit as they've grown up a little bit. If I was to tell them that I am dying now, they would sort of wake up every morning thinking, is Mum going to die today? Because kids of that age don't have much time perspective.
Yeah, they don't.
So, like, if you're going to take a kid to Disneyland or to do something really exciting, you don't tell them a year beforehand. Mm. You tell them a week before or a couple of weeks before and say, you know, we're going, because they couldn't handle the excitement. And in my case, it's they wouldn't be able to handle the trauma,
yeah,
because they would think that that was happening every day. They would think, is it going to happen today?
Is it going to happen today, yeah.
Yeah, I've already had them say, you know, like Hamilton says, when are you going to die? Are you going to be eight when I die? Am I going to be eight when you die, Mum? Or am I going to be seven? How old will I be when you die?
I think it's important to try and get across the uncertainty. As doctors, we cannot say exactly how long someone's going to live. We don't have that power. We're not gods.
Ashley, before the break, we were hearing some contrasting ways of dealing with, yep, this kind of information. I'm interested in asking you about that a little more, because you studied science and yet you don't want to know some of the detail that perhaps science could offer you. Why?
I'd always had this sort of belief that I'll get better when I find the key, when I find the right drug, the right treatment, the right combination, the right thing I have to eat. But I actually spoke to someone, a counsellor, and she looked at me and she said, it's not a matter of getting better when you find it, but you're actually getting better now. And I feel that sort of talks about that belief and that actually knowing, where it wasn't an intellectual concept. It was like, I actually knew I was going to get better and I knew I was going to
get
better.
So that was the hope.
That was the hope.
Wendy's talking about.
So I understand knowledge is a two-edged sword. It can be, if it's used for empowering, then it can be really beneficial. But if it's also knowledge that weighs you down and crushes that hope, then people give up. And if you give up, then you do worse.
Mm. Okay. Belinda, you are the doctor who told Penny the range of time that she could expect to live. Let's just briefly go back and have a look at how you opened up that conversation.
If we imagine we had 100 people just like you, mm-hmm, who all had your sort of breast cancer that had spread to the liver and the bones and the brain, and we'd probably see the sort of middle 50 of that 100 people would probably be living between probably sort of 2 months to 8 months.
Now, you're actually studying how doctors should be having these conversations. Why did you approach it that way? And how important is it to actually for doctors to think through the way they speak to people about
I think
this?
It's incredibly important, as we've seen from the people up here this evening talking about their experiences. And I think that it's very common to have people say that they were told 6 months or 3 months. And I think that we need to get doctors to not be just giving that one number, which is really a limit. And I think what I think is important is to try and give a range of scenarios where there is no limit. And I think it's important to try and get across the uncertainty. As doctors, we cannot say exactly how long someone's going to live. We don't have that power. We're not gods. And I think what we can do is we can look at what other people in this situation have done before. And we do see that there are going to be some people that will live a very short time, and there will be some that will live a very long time, and most people will fall in between that. And that's how I've sort of been approaching these conversations.
Megan, how much do you take in what you're told when you're in that room?
Everything. Very much so. I really agree that the knowledge is power. It's allowing us to know how to deal with that stage and what stage are we up to and what do we need to do in this stage to prepare us for that next stage.
Wendy, did the specialist know that you weren't translating to your father, that it was terminal cancer that he had?
I think he knows something happened. I didn't interpret everything to my dad. But in the following conversation and the following consultation, he keeps chasing me, say, have you told your dad about his diagnosis and the later stage prognosis?
And what did you say?
I say, I didn't give them yes, I didn't give them no.
This must have been a very tense relationship.
Yes,
at this
it's
point,
very
I
tense.
Imagine.
It's very frustrating, actually, the relationship between Carol's and patient, the doctors, the relationship at the beginning is not good. I think this gave me a great pressure. I don't think I did something wrong because I did everything for beneficial of my dad. I came across different specialists and doctors, and I think majority of them couldn't understand me. They say, why you did such things? But I came across a very a super doctor specialist, she gave me great support, say, this is not, it's a legal obligation. Say, you have to tell the patient straight away what's the diagnosis, what prognosis. But we don't force your culture to accept this one.
Richard, you work in palliative care. I wonder how you feel listening to that story. I mean, what would you do if a family member chose not to translate something that you'd said to the patient?
I guess I have the advantage of being able to understand Chinese.
How do you react when you hear that as a health professional yourself?
I think Wendy's absolutely right that the culture that she's brought up in and the culture that I'm brought up in is one of taking over the decision-making from our elders, because that's how our culture has taught us to behave. And part of not telling the diagnosis to a loved one or elderly is what we would normally do.
So how, as a doctor, do you deal with that?
What I do, bringing a little bit of my Western culture, is to try and find out what the patient actually knows. And very often, patients would have seen their parents pass on from whatever cause, from cancer, from a heart attack, from a stroke. They have seen death themselves.
And so you're saying the patients sometimes know anyway?
Yes. And it's not uncommon for patients to hide the fact that they know that they have cancer from their children. And children hiding the fact that they know that they have cancer. And therefore, there's a double collusion on both sides, and therefore, nothing's ever said.
How would you deal with that, Alan? How would you deal with a situation like that?
Not a matter of how I deal with this particular situation, but we have enshrined in the Code of Conduct from the Medical Board of Australia a couple of key principles. One is to be culturally respectful, but also to ensure that there's patient autonomy and there's shared decision-making. In this particular case, what has been denied to the patient has been the option of not having chemotherapy and avoiding those side effects. If that patient had known the diagnosis and had been informed fully about the diagnosis. So that's an aspect that has not been touched upon this evening. The other aspect that needs to be touched upon in terms of being culturally respectful and patient autonomy, putting on a research hat, melanoma, breast cancer, bowel cancer, all have had huge advances of late in cancer genetics, let alone conventional treatment. Those advances would not occur if the attitude of not telling people they had cancer was prevalent, because we need people to provide samples so that research can continue. With an attitude that tries to hide cancer and a family history of cancer, if that attitude was prevalent, those advances in gene testing that allow the next generation an opportunity for prevention, and if not that early detection, would not exist today.
I'm interested, though, at a really practical level, in how you would deal with an example like this.
Number one, we would have an interpreter. That goes without saying. That's hospital policy and it's state policy. And the reason for that is patient autonomy. You would have an interpreter, and that would obviate the issue that we've seen here of obfuscation of the diagnosis, because that patient needs to be able to make his or her own decision if they're mentally capable of doing so.
Gary, you work in palliative care. How would you deal with a situation like this?
In this particular situation, if I was faced with that, I would say, tell me about a time when Dad, in fact, suffered a loss. You know, has there been, did he lose his job? Was there a sibling who died? Tell me, how did Dad cope with that situation? And Wendy would, I'm sure, tell us about the fact that he would have been very saddened or something might have happened. Well, how did he deal with it? And I think the last comment I want to make is often when I turn to that particular person like Wendy and say, Wendy, tell me, if you were in this situation, how much information would you like?
How much information would you like, Wendy?
I have to go back. For me, if personally, I would accept it, but I still would not accept, like, life expectancy told by the doctor. I think, go back to the beginning.
But would you want to know?
Yeah, no problem for me to
know. If your condition was terminal?
That's right.
Where do you strike a balance with something like this?
I have to gauge, and I want to gauge what a patient wants to know. I look after Judith, who's in the audience as well. We've had a conversation about her prognosis, and I was very honest with her, and she appreciated the honesty and was able to plan. It's to support her through the journey that she's on at the moment and to walk with her on that journey.
Is that how it works, Judith?
That is how it works. And I have to say that I couldn't have anyone better than Richard holding my hand and walking with me.
Mm. Maria, I wanted to talk to you. You were told just days after your son Tristan was born that he had a terminal condition. Do you remember how you were told?
We were told in one sitting that Tristan had a diagnosis of listen carefully, that he was most likely blind, he was most likely deaf, and his intellectual ability was zero.
Now, this condition is a condition of the brain.
It's a neuronal migratory disorder. And, what it meant was that Tristan would have a lot of physical and some intellectual disability as well. And I think they mentioned that Tristan's life expectancy was likely to be 1 month. And I think everything else just blurred out at that moment. I didn't take anything else in, and I was beside myself.
Mm. How old is he now?
Tristan's 17, recently turned 17, so it's been a very long journey.
And here he is the other day.
Are you excited about the program? Yay, there's a thumbs up! Can you say hello to Sunita with your thumb?
Oh, yes, good job! Big one! Big thumbs up! Massive thumbs up! Okay, which movie are we going to go for?
Would you like to go for a movie? Or we're going to watch Chennai Express?
That's a good idea.
He's a Bruno Mars fan, I hear, too. Is that right?
He does love Bruno Mars. I think we'd had Tristan wear a hat on once, and the girl who was looking after him at the time said, "Geez, Tristan, you look like Bruno Mars." And we were like, "Who is Bruno Mars?" And then we sort of listened to a bit of his music, and it seemed like every single time Bruno Mars came on the radio, Tristan would immediately be smiling. And so the biggest thing, like, you know, we've lived day to day, we've never tried to look forward because we don't want disappointment in our life. I don't want to make plans for the future that are not going to happen.
Because you know this condition is terminal. Yes.
I know the condition is terminal. And earlier this year, when Bruno Mars tickets went on sale, because he's coming to Australia next February, like, for the first time in my life, I'd actually bought tickets for a concert that was 12 months ahead. And I was like, "Tristan, you're hanging in there. You're coming to the show whether you like it or not." Because I don't know what I'm going to say to ticketing. I think I scared the poor person on the ticketing counter when I'm like, "So what happens if the person's not there for the show?" And the person at the other end went, "No refunds, no, you know, no cancellations." I'm like, "But what if the person dies?" And I think I scared the poor person. I suddenly realised it's probably a young kid on the end of the phone.
But it's obviously something at the front of your mind.
It is all the time.
Fabian, what do you think? I mean, how has your family reacted
initially
to the prognosis?
So it was really hard at that stage to even to break the news to our parents. So I think we didn't let them know, I think, probably about a week or so later, because we were just devastated. We just thought something will come about, until we gradually broke the news to them. And they said, it cannot happen. And that is a typical Indian way of saying it. It cannot happen. So they just said, just sit down there and pray, and you'll see in 1 month's time, he'll be better. So prayer is very big for both our families and in our culture as well.
Sometimes I felt that, you know, there was a lot of pressure on us, because someone said to me once, in the Bible, there's a line that says you need faith the size of a mustard seed to move a mountain. And they said, "Maria, your faith is the most important." And so every time we prayed and nothing happened, I thought I was to blame. So it just added to my guilt and my feeling of being responsible.
Connie?
So many people say to me, "I just can't believe that you're not going to beat this. If you just think positive enough, if you just, you know, really focus and do all the right things, then you'll get better. I just know it. I know it in my heart. You'll get better." And it does actually, it can actually have the opposite effect from what they're intending, in that it can put that responsibility on you. And if I don't get better, it's my fault.
That's right.
And it can actually produce guilt rather than what they're trying to do, which is trying to make us all feel better. And
does it make you feel cranky as well?
Oh, I get pretty riled sometimes.
I'd be really cranky if people kept telling me that, if I wasn't feeling it.
And, you know, some cancers are treatable and some aren't. And mine was initially and it now isn't. And no amount of positive thinking, yoga, meditation, praying or anything is going to change that outcome for me. Or for me, a really essential part of the process is to accept that so that I can really live my life to the fullest when I'm feeling well enough to do so.
It's so different though, Astley, to the way that you're approaching it, isn't it?
Well, on that positive thinking, I actually realise, I think that people tell you to be positive, tell you to be strong, not for you, they tell them for themselves. They're not comfortable with the fact that here's someone who may potentially be sick, who may die, and they're not comfortable with death themselves. And through that, like, you also realise who's actually, people who ask, how are you going? What's up? Like, how are you? They actually care and they want to know, whereas the rest who just say, be positive, they don't.
Wendy, what's it like listening to that?
Yes, I have to come back to that question you asked me. I didn't answer straight away, say, what's my reaction if I wasn't being told? I think most of, I remember one of my friends, the Aussie friends, said to me, if I were your dad, I'd be very angry because you didn't tell me the truth. When the patient gets sicker and sicker, he knew something wrong, definitely wrong. Yeah. But the things for us, we don't say the word, but don't talk about it because it's very hard for us to start this conversation.
Did you have any support?
Yeah, I do, but not that much, not enough.
I think Wendy's point, though, is that she's sitting in a culture that isn't conducive to understanding her needs and her family's needs necessarily in this situation.
I think we failed Wendy and her family, that our health system wasn't able to support Wendy, when I think we should be. We are doing research at University of Sydney where we are trying to understand what the cultural needs are, not only of the Chinese culture, but Italians, Greeks, and having an understanding from an Australian perspective, especially when families are very dislocated from their home countries, how we can actually deal and help patients like these, and carers as well.
You doctors are dealing with incredible complexity here, and I'm just very interested in talking to you about this idea of a time frame and how you approach that. Do you always give people a time frame?
No, I think a lot of the time, I think everybody is very different and we're seeing different opinions here this evening, and I think that I don't give everybody a time frame. I think that I find that most patients do want some sort of general idea, certainly whether their cancer is curable or not, but then usually a general idea of how long it might be. And I think really approaching it by saying, finding out what sort of information they want. Some people do want the specific details of the numbers and the timeframes. Others just want the very general, and some don't want it at all.
Do you give timeframes, Richard?
No, I don't. I would sometimes say you have weeks to months, and that's the time frame that I give. Some people take away that Dr. Chaya said 2 weeks when the team around me would tell me he never said that, but sometimes patients will actually take that away. Sometimes I use slightly different words. For example, in someone who is very sick, I would say to them, it would be a bonus if you were still here during Christmas. So that doesn't give them any time frames, but also give them an idea, well, it's a bonus if I get to Christmas. That means there's still a chance to get to Christmas, but without actually saying you're going to be dead before Christmas. That's not the way we do it.
Just to give some perspective to the rest of the audience, how many times a year would you give a terminal diagnosis to a patient, Belinda?
Probably once a week, you'd be having a discussion with someone, either telling them they've got an incurable cancer or explaining their survival time. Mm.
Richard, how often would you be doing it?
I think that's very similar as well.
About once a week.
For me, once every few weeks. What we're seeing is the variability in the human condition and the reference to personalised care and medicine. And in order to get into medical school, one of the key questions and attributes we look for is tolerance of ambiguity. because there is a huge variability and there's no one size fits all. There's no right answer to a lot of things we deal with.
Is there any evidence at all that a prognosis affects how long people live?
Not that I...
There has been some studies looking at that and they haven't been able to correlate knowing your prognosis with worse survival time or even worse depression scores on different questionnaires and scales.
Hi, my name's Samuel Johnson. My sister Connie is dying from breast cancer. Earlier this year, I made her a promise to put a permanent dent into this horrible disease.
But also to get the message out to men that they can save a life by groping their wife.
Obviously, this is not the life we thought. We got married thinking we were going to have a healthy family, go camping. So Aiden's life is very up and down, and one minute he can be perfectly fine running around playing football and the next he'll be gone.
Can we tackle him? Can we tackle me?
So Aiden has Pearson syndrome, which is a mitochondrial disorder. It's rare, and essentially what it means is that his organs will eventually shut down one by one.
Tackle!
The last numerical number that we had was that he's got 15% kidney function. And I tell myself intellectually that he's dying, but emotionally I don't let myself believe it or accept it. Said to us, they said, we don't know a whole lot, but statistics show early infancy. His amount of empathy is like nothing I've ever seen any child. He is so gentle.
We had a blood test and he's like, are you okay? He held my hand for a blood test. I'm like, I'm fine, mate. Like.
Carly, how much does Aiden know?
I think Aiden knows he's special, obviously, because he plays on that fact a lot. And he quite enjoys going to hospital. Intellectually, he's about 3, so he understands the concept of dying in terms of we'll watch a movie and someone will get shot and he'll say they've died. But I think at 3, you don't really understand that that's a permanent situation and what that means. So, yeah.
And how is the situation you find yourselves in affecting both of you and your day-to-day decisions, the decisions you make?
Yeah, and I think it was Maria who said before that you can't make plans and every day is a new day. You know, we don't plan what we're going to do for Christmas because we don't know if that's going to happen. And you just have to accept that tomorrow might be a really hot day and he won't cope with that and he won't survive. And that's the reality. But, you know, he can always defy the odds and keep going, and that's what he's been doing. But it's not always going to be the way.
And where does that leave you? How does that leave you feeling?
In limbo land.
No man's land.
Yeah, and I often say I wish I had that crystal ball because you don't know. And I've always been a planner, and not knowing what's going to happen from one day to the next is one of the hardest parts, I think, about it.
How have you changed, or have you changed, the way you live your life, Connie, since you've known?
You try and focus on the important things, you know, family and, you know, I was advised, you know, to leave work so that I could spend the energy that I do have on my children. And I've done that. And so, you know, we're under significant financial pressure. So, it changes your life financially, it changes it socially, it changes it. The ability to plan is a really big thing. I guess everybody approaches it in a different way, but for me, I'm just trying to spend that time building memories with my kids. That's my focus now.
And here's what else your family and friends are doing.
Yeah.
Hi, my name's Samuel Johnson. My sister Connie is dying from breast cancer. Earlier this year, I made her a promise. I gave her my word that before she dies, I would ride a unicycle around the entire country, raise $1 million, break a world record, and do whatever it takes to put a permanent dent into this horrible disease.
They've got an album each at the moment. Trying to keep a record for the boys of how much I love them.
Yeah.
Isn't it cute?
Yeah.
Can't die before they'll remember me. There has to be
a point.
A point.
Okay, so I've come up with a motto for the ride. I don't know. I just figure we can't kind of be misery gutses. No one's going to want to hear another hard luck story. Don't fall into the booby trap. Get yourself checked.
I love it.
Yeah? The support vehicle being a big boobmobile.
The boobmobile.
Yeah, he rides around in it every day. He's got it.
Why do you think Sam chose that way? You know, riding a unicycle around Australia to help him deal with your illness?
Well, just after I was diagnosed as terminal, he asked me what I wanted to do with the rest of my life. And I think he expected me to say, let's go skydiving or something. But I said that I wanted to prevent other mums from having to say goodbye to their children because of this disease. And early detection is the key. So he said, how are we going to do that? And I said, look, I think you're going to have to get on your unicycle. It's that or a pogo stick. We've got to do something different, you know. We've got to get people's attention. And he's done that. He's getting people's attention. We've raised $950,000 so far. He's been on the road and ridden over 12,000 kilometres. And he's been on the road since February 15. He'll be finishing in February next year. That's been a big goal for me, to make February next year so that I can be there to welcome him home and to finish our project together. What we're doing is called Love Your Sister, he named it. And I guess it's about early detection. It's about telling people, telling women to be proactive about their health. Don't fall into the booby trap, because that's essentially what I did. Not only are we trying to raise the money for breast cancer research, but also to get the message out to women to be breast aware, and to men that they can save a life by groping their wife.
I think you've adopted a very popular approach to this, to this problem. Okay, Aranea, your sister Bouvea died of cystic fibrosis nearly a year ago. How do you think your family dealt with her approach to knowing that she was going to die?
She was ready. She'd been ready to die for a long time. She'd suffered for a long time. And so she took it. I hear people say about the journey. Sorry, that's hard.
I'm sorry.
That's all right. She's okay now. Her journey was ready to be over, and she made it about herself, and it wasn't about anyone else, or it wasn't about us.
Hmm.
So that's, although it might sound a bit more sad, she wasn't as positive. She was like, okay, I'm going to go out on my terms. And when she was given a few months, if things kept continuing, she said, well, no, I'm going to cut all my meds, I'm going to go out on my terms, and it lasted about 2 weeks.
Maria, you've stopped asking about a prognosis for Tristan now. Yep.
Yeah, I think, the emphasis on the time frames was too much for me. Initially, they told us a month, and then when we saw the doctors, we were like, oh, he's made it to a month. What happens next? And then it was a year, and then, you know, they kept mentioning time frames, that we've been able to fulfill a wish for Tristan or find out what his bucket list is and stuff like that. But what we've learned to do is to make memories, like Connie mentioned, to spend time with Tristan.
Carly, what are your priorities? And Anthony, what are your priorities now for Aidan and for yourselves?
Look, for Aidan, I mean, you know, we're talking all about time frames and stuff. Our doctors have always been very open about there is no real time frame. We think so many patients die at this age and so many patients don't. And we just want him to be happy. And, you know, we want him to be a child.
Mm. Astley, what about you? Priorities now? Is there a bucket list? Are there things that you really want to do?
Living my life the best way I can, helping others I can. I run a support group for young adults with cancer as well. And just offering some hope and peace and love to those around me and those that I care for.
And Connie, what about you? What are your priorities at the moment? You mentioned a bucket list before. Do you have one?
Yeah, I do. I think the most important thing is spending time with my boys, which is my husband and my two young boys. Seeing Love Your Sister through to its natural conclusion and raising as much money as we can, but also importantly spreading that message of breast awareness. And scrapbooking, I really want to leave, I don't know, evidence on paper.
So you're putting together scrapbooks?
Yeah, for my kids. But I'd like to write a book. I'd like to go to France. I love France and all things French. I learned the language. I've taught my kids French. They're bilingual and I've never been there. But it's not always realistic because I can't get insurance to travel to France. Doing Love Your Sister and the scrapbooks.
May there be many more of those moments for you, for all
thank
of you.
You.
And thank you so much for joining us tonight. Really appreciate all of you sharing your stories. And special thanks to Penny as well, who couldn't stay for the entire program to join us tonight. But we're very grateful she was there at the beginning. Thank you, Penny. And thank you, Paul, as well. We do have to wrap it up here now, but you can keep talking online. Go to our website, Twitter, or Insight's Facebook page. Next week on Insight.
I now have an attitude of reasonable indifference towards them. I've grown to ignore the fact that they are there. At 15, as strange as it sounds, one day I just woke up and decided I don't want to do this anymore.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thank you, everyone. Fabulous.